Hello, Paleo fans, and welcome back to another vlog video. My name is Paleo Tufts, and this is Paleo Adventures. It's been a week since I've been in South Dakota, and I like it. It's good. I went with Paleo Adventures last year, and I loved it. So I'm back again, this time volunteering, and today I'm going to take you along to see Tooth Draw. So let's go. Yep, I'm back once again on a dinosaur dig, but this time it's in South Dakota. I've been to South Dakota last year in 2015 with the same company, and Paleo Ventures did not disappoint. I was so excited to come back here again. I found Tyrannosaur teeth, a Nanotyrannus tooth, and other people I found some other cool things. And this is where our trip begins. Well, we're here at Paleo Adventures, so let's go take a little small orientation.
That was a rock. We're going to be working at the Tooth Draw Quarry. It's a place called the Tooth Draw Quarry. It's an ancient river channel deposit. It's roughly about 66 million years old. It's late Cretaceous. And a lot of the bones and teeth and things have been tumbling down this river system for a while. So there's a lot of broken bits and pieces. There's also a lot of sandstone, and a lot of gravel. Or conglomerate, the appropriate geological term. The gravel is composed of mudstone pebbles. They look like this. Mudstone, claystone, usually a grayish color, well rounded. There's also a lot of ironstone in there. This is a typical ironstone pebble. Okay, go ahead and pass it around. So those are both rocks. You're going to see lots of those. The bones are going to be broken up and tumbled and around the rock, around all those pebbles in the gravel. Okay? And there's four main ways to tell the difference between them. The first is going to be the color. There's a dinosaur bone sitting in the sand. See, it has a bit of a darker color than the sandstone. It really stands out in the dark next to the yellow sand. And you can see from these, it can sometimes be confused with the pebbles. But typically, the dinosaur bone is going to be darker than the surrounding rock. It's going to have a bit of a shine to it. Usually have a little bit more of a polished shine to them. And they tend to be this kind of almost a purplish color. They have a bit of a purplish cast from the tooth draw quarry. Right here we have two tail vertebrae, both dinosaur, but you see they have a slightly different shape. Okay? And of course, obviously, if you see something with a weird shape to it, pay close attention, it's probably not just a rock. Okay? Now, the shape is what I'm going to use to help identify it. As to which bone, what part of the body it's coming from, also what species and genus of animal it came from. Okay? So here again, we have two tail vertebrae. This one's drum-shaped. This is probably from the Triceratops. Can you tell us what a Triceratops is?
It has like a frill kind of, and it has two horns and one
head. Excellent. Excellent. The name Triceratops means three-horned face. Right? So you got two horns over the eyes, one over the nose, big frill of bone protecting the back of the neck, and a big display showy. Big animals, because they could reach 30, 35 feet long. And even though they ate plants, you probably wouldn't want to mess with them. They were more like a buffalo than anything else. Pretty easily protect itself with those horns. This other one here is shield-shaped. And that shape tells me that it came from the second most common dinosaur out there, and that's Edmontosaurus, also known as a duck-billed dinosaur. Now, duckies, as I like to call them, duckies have this bill like a duck, almost like a beak kind of thing. And they also have a lot of closely spaced teeth for grinding up plants. You can see this is a wonderful tooth battery here. Lots of closely spaced teeth for grinding up plants. Big coronoid process for muscle attachments for grinding and stuff. And they get pretty big too, upwards of 35, 40 feet for them. For us, everybody does it differently, but for us, we kind of split our fossils into three categories. Common, commercial grade, and scientific grade. We try and keep everybody happy, try and do a balance of things. Common stuff are fragments of dinosaur bone, tumbled chips and chunks like this. I'd much rather see this in a kid's hand and inspire them, get them excited about science and paleontology. Far more valuable in a kid's hand or a teacher's hand than it is sitting in a museum basement collecting dust. Okay? So little fragments like this we let you keep. And if you follow my directions, you should bring home a nice little bag full of dinosaur bone fragments and things like that. Little sections of rib bone that have no tooth marks or any obvious signs of a reason for that breakage just tumbled down the roof. You may keep those. Some other things that you may keep are things like this. This is it's kind of flat, platey. A lot of times you just see them sticking out of the quarry wall, a little thin brown line. And they have this dimpled texture. Do you remember what that is, Bambi?
What? It's like a plate of like a crocodile or an alligator.
Close. Huh? What? Do you remember? No, go ahead.
It's turtle shell.
Turtle shell. Excellent. That's right. This is a piece of turtle shell, and they have that dimpled texture, kind of like a golf ball. There's about 30 different species out there in the Hell Creek, and they're all pretty similar. That's a banded pond turtle kind of thing. Okay. And too often, though, people, they get excited. They think they see a fossil, and they want to try and attack it from the side. That'd be a big mistake. You never want to dig under it or from the side. You always want to find the flat part, flat edge, and work from the top down and glue it as you go. Okay? Because they are exceptionally fragile. Some other things out there, you'll be sick of these by lunchtime. They're black, they're shiny, they're kind of diamond shaped. What do you think that is?
Tooth?
A lot of times I'll think it's a tooth, I'll see it sticking out of the sand, I go, whoa, it's a tooth, yay! And then, no, scale. It's a garfish scale. Because it's a river system, there's a lot of fish material in there, and it tends to be black and shiny. The scales are very resistant to erosion, so they hold up fairly well. So, those you may keep, those you'll be sick of those by lunch. Alright, now you mentioned crocodiles and alligators. There's an alligator scoop. Tyler found an awesome one yesterday. We were out exploring. Because it's a river system, just about anything living along the rivers and in the rivers are going to be there, including crocodiles and alligators. Way back when, it was a much, much warmer climate. So we have alligators and crocodiles clear up here living comfortably. And scutes, or the scales, are quite common, and the teeth are quite common. There's a crocodile tooth, a Lytisuchus. The alligators tend to be a little bit more bullet-shaped, more blunt. Okay, but any alligator and crocodile teeth you may keep, any scooch you may keep, bones I have to keep. And if you find anything from a species called Dinosuchus, that's a big monster croc, those I would have. Okay. But common species like that you may keep. Some other things we consider common enough to sell are tyrannosaur teeth. Tyrannosaurs are also replacing their teeth over and over and over again, so we do find lots and lots of tyrannosaur teeth out there. One of the things our tooth draw quarry is known for is the number of theropod and tyrannosaur teeth that we find. Now there's two types of tyrannosaurs. Obviously T-Rex, everybody loves T-Rex, one of the most awesome carnivores to ever walk the planet. 45 feet long, big sharp nasty pointy teeth. Look over there on the wall, you see a cast jaw, big monster teeth. Tyrannosaur teeth are highly prized by collectors, and so when you find one of those, we all get excited and happy and jump up and down. And you see it's got kind of a rounded tip. T-Rex teeth are almost blunt. It's designed for crushing and breaking bone. One of the most powerful bite forces in the animal kingdom, somewhere around 14,000-15,000 pounds per square inch.
What about Nanotyrannus?
Forget about Nanotyrannus. Nanotyrannus is another smaller version of T-Rex. Some paleontologists argue that Nanotyrannus is just a baby T-Rex. I disagree. I think there's enough differences in the skull and the teeth to give it a separate designation. But the jury's still out. We need to find more data to be absolutely 100% certain. Anyway, the teeth of Nanotyrannus tend to be slightly different. They tend to be a little bit more sharp, a little pointy. They have very fine serrations, and they're laterally compressed teeth. And we can see big teeth. I'm going to compare the two. By comparison, and this isn't a great comparison, unfortunately, because this one is a little bit bigger than that one, but the serrations tend to be quite a bit coarser and more laterally compressed.
It's more blade-like,
more
basically.
Blade-like. Yeah.
T-Rex teeth are like railroad spikes, and this is like a knife.
there's a juvenile T-Rex. It's a stouter tooth. Now, they're in the same family, so they're very close, but there are fine differences that you can see if you look at them really closely. All right. That's Nano. That brings us to the real fun stuff, the reason why I'm out there, the scientific grade stuff. When it comes to science, size doesn't matter. I'd much rather have one of these smaller bones in this case here than, you know, a couple of these big clunky ducky bones. These are important. They're rare dinosaurs. They tell us a story. They teach us how the deposit was formed, or they teach us about the ecosystem and the habitat and diversity of animal life out there. So, very important for science. This is a clunky ducky bone. Everybody's got one. You know, they're fun. They pay the bills. But other than that, this is what helps understand ancient life. We have things like Struthiomimus, a very rare dinosaur out there. What's a Struthiomimus? No? How about Pachycephalosaurus? What's Pachycephalosaurus? Yeah, we got one up there on top of the bookshelf. That's a cast of sand Pachycephalosaurus.
Really rare.
Very rare. There's only a handful of skulls, really good skulls, about five or six skulls now. Only one real good body to Pachycephalosaurus. So all the little isolated bones are important. Things like Oviraptorids. There's a giant Oviraptor out there called Anzu. You find a bone of that, very important. Raptors. Raptors are one of my favorites. Everybody loves raptors. You guys seen Jurassic Park?
Mm-hmm. I watched all of them and I loved them.
Did you? What's your favorite one?
First one and the last one.
Yeah, I think that's everybody's vote. Usually number one, number four, number two, number three, in that kind of order. Yeah. Well, anyway, this is a raptor bone. Now, raptor claw. This is not Velociraptor. Velociraptor was only found over in Asia. This is a special one called a Acaroraptor. Can you say that for me, please? A Acaroraptor? It's okay. Anyway, this was found by a 14-year-old boy on one of my trips. And he brings it over to me in three pieces, and he says, "Is this something?" And I said, "Yes, you can't have it." I had to steal that one from him, right? Why did I have to steal it? No.
It's rare.
Because it's very, very rare. Raptor bones are hollow, they're bird-like. These are bird-like animals. Hollow bones did not preserve well, and they often break apart. So you don't find any, there are any complete skeletons of a raptor in the elephant. There's been one partial, we'll talk about that later. Anyway, this boy brings it over to me in three pieces. What did that boy do right?
Brought it to you, eventually.
He brought it to my attention, right? He told me about it. What did he do wrong?
He didn't tell you early enough.
He didn't tell me early enough. He popped it out of the rock and brought it to me. I was 20 feet away. And when he popped it out, it wasn't ready yet. It hadn't been glued, it hadn't been stabilized. And when he brought it over to me, he forgot where he had found it. Right? When we find something scientifically significant, we want to map it in place. I want to know what direction it's pointing. I want to know what direction it dips in. Okay? If it's dipping to the northeast, I need to know that. If it is down low in the strata, I need to know that. A good example is, let's say you find a raptor bone at the bottom, and later on I find a raptor bone at the top of the deposit. Are they from the same animal?
Yeah.
Probably not.
No, probably not. Yeah,
but
different levels, different
times when
travel lenses, different times. Yeah.
Yep.
So probably not from the same animal. But if I find a raptor bone down low and another one 2 feet away is also a raptor bone, similar size, could that be from the same animal?
Mm-hmm.
That could be from the same animal. So very, very important to map everything we find and log it and understand the geology and the stratigraphy. Up here, if we look up on the wall, this is our quarry map. And you see, to an untrained eye, it may look like these bones were, you know, a dinosaur swallowed a couple grenades, right? But to the trained eye, to a geologist, what we look for is a preferred orientation, directions where these bones are pointing, particularly the long bones. And from this, we can kind of tell that the current was coming in probably from northwest to south-southeast, kind of like this. Okay? You can see some of the orientations of some of the bones, especially the long bones by themselves are all kind of pointing that way. When they're in a pile, they're perpendicular to the current direction. So we look for some sort of preferred orientation to those bones. Okay. Now, point out in this case here, this is probably one of the most significant, scientifically significant bones we found from the quarry. This is an actual Tyrannosaurus rex jaw, sitting here in a barn in Belfouche. One day this will wind up in a museum someday. In fact, all of our scientific grade stuff goes to museums. They're either sold or donated. And right now we've donated to four separate institutions, University of Kansas, Smithsonian. We just sent a small package up to North Carolina and a small package up to Terrell. But eventually it's gonna wind up in a good home. Now, this here, this T-Rex jaw is very important, not only because it's T-Rex and rare, but also because it has weird bite marks on it. We've got these wonderful re-healed bites, one, two, three. That hole there is natural, actually, but there's another one there and another one there. And then there's this scrape that goes down, a little bit raised tissue there. The big one here is right near the front, and there's two big circular holes. Looks like a larger rex was tussling with it. They might have been face biting or something like that, and it actually punctured it. That's one possible scenario. Another possible scenario is we have an infection from a protozoa called Trichomonas, which sometimes causes holes in modern bird dogs. And it could also possibly be a dental infection. We did CT scan it. You see the CT scan here, and even though you can't see the teeth, there's actually some unerupted teeth that are actually in there. Okay.
It takes about 2 hours from Belfouche to get to the private cattle ranch that we dig on. But once we get to the ranch, it gets pretty fun on the way up. Hold on.
Here we go.
Well, we made it to Tooth Draw, and it's a fantastic view.
Alright guys, we're here at Tooth Draw, so let's get digging.
Before we start digging, Walter will gladly show you how to dig for dinosaur bones properly in Tooth Draw. Today, unfortunately, we didn't find too much stuff, but me, on the other hand, I found something quite big and impressive.
Well, I'm chasing something right here. I'm not so sure what it is, but in time I'll know. Man, what is this thing? I'm gonna go to lunch, but when I come back, I'll do some more on this work.
Oh, wow.
Well, I did a little bit of digging, and it looks like this might be part of a Triceratops skull, but we're not too sure yet, but we'll keep on digging and see what we get.
Well, this is all we're doing right now, but we'll come back tomorrow and fix this up.
Well, unfortunately, we couldn't find any Tyrannosaur teeth. There were no Tyrannosaurus or Nanotyrannus right for today. But I am coming back tomorrow, and we'll be checking around here once again. The weather, as you can see, is a little bit stormy. There's thunder around here somewhere, so we better get going. And it's my last day tomorrow here, so let's see if we can find some Tyrannosaur teeth. See you in a bit. Well, it's day two, and we're heading back up to Tooth Draw. Hopefully I will get that Triceratops frill out of there, but we'll see what happens. And I also found a piece of bone that was sticking out on the cliff right behind us, so I'll take a look at that as well. So let's go back to Tooth Draw.
This time the weather looks so much better than it was yesterday, and I think we're going to be looking at a second site nearby Tooth Draw. Let's take a look.
Well, before we go to the Tooth Draw quarry, we're going to be searching around this area if there's any new bones sticking out. And also in this hill over here, it's possibly the Tertiary boundary and the Cretaceous down below. And hopefully, with some luck, we might find the KT boundary, or the KPG, which is now called. It's pretty much the site of Armageddon. That's where the dinosaurs have suddenly been obliterated by an asteroid. about 65 million years ago. So let's go see what we can find.
At some point, when we get sick and tired of tooth draw, we might come over here and open this up, take an excavator, and begin to excavate.
So what's that right there? Is that an Edmontosaurus?
I think it's a part of a Triceratops or an Edmontosaurus pelvic bone.
Hmm. What is this here?
Ischia, probably.
Man, it's so windy here.
Fresh friends and neighbors. As we go and watch the ground as we go. Gonna be a lot of ups and downs up into that set of badlands. This is what we typically think of when we think of badlands. Pioneers saw stuff like that out there. They said that was bad land. It was too dry, couldn't grow crops on it. You couldn't even run cattle on it very well because there's not enough grass on it. The proper geomorphic term, badlands, means land that is eroding so quickly that grass can't grow on it. And so there could be dinosaurs out there in the grass, but it's real hard to find them there. You have to trip over them, much like I did over here at the Ironstone site. Down here is where we look for stuff tumbling out of the wall. Okay, so we'll go back to walking single file. Again, watch for snakes. Be safe. There's going to be a lot of steep up and downs. If you feel yourself slip, slide down on your butt. Okay, if we go up and down, walk sideways like this down the hill. Okay, all right, follow me.
So far, what's this? Yeah, nothing. Oh, no, it's something. Then I refound it and slid.
Yeah.
Like that.
Whoa. Yeah, well, the wind blow you all over the place.
And there's some fragments right behind your feet, right by your feet, in front of your feet.
Oh, yeah, there's a whole train of them all the way
in
down.
In front of your feet right there. Foot.
Well, that was fun. Let's go down to tooth draw and see what else we can find.
All right, two tooth draw.
You found this over there in the gully?
Mm-hmm.
Down there. Yeah, this is an ankylosaur tooth. It's kind of leaf-shaped. You got these little big, sharp barbules or denticles on the sides. And you can see it's set into a tooth socket. So a little different than your duck-billed dinosaur teeth. Rounded socket. So that's ankylosaur. It's a very good find. This is scientifically significant. This is one we'll hold on for science, so you'll get your name in the book.
Okay? All right, well done.
Tap in.
So. Alright guys, I'm back here. I'm gonna start working on this trike shield again. Hopefully we'll find more of it.
You say that again?
It's in rough condition though, because the tip is worn off and it's got these weird pits all over the surface. But this is the flex tubercle right there. And this is where it's gonna the articular facet for the finger bones, the phalanges. And you can see the evidence of the blood groove right up there. You're missing probably, it looks like, missing part of it. Maybe we'll screen this debris and see if we can find any any bits.
So an Anzu, all right.
I think so. That's a little bone fragment of something, but not from this.
That is a nice hand claw.
Well, it's not. It's not great condition, but it's weird looking. Look at all the pits on that thing.
Pathological, maybe?
It might be pathological. No, we donated a big bone to the University of Kansas a while back, and the gentleman there, we're going to hopefully co-author a paper at some point, or he's going to put together a paper. But some of these pits might actually be from beetle borings. So this was sitting out on the surface for a while. So we'll have to.
What if a T-Rex swallowed it?
Well, that would be kind of cool, but I don't think it will. That would be cool.
That's really cool.
Yeah.
So that's a pre-max of a baby Tyrannosaurus Rex. That is a nice find. Well done.
So Thistlosaurus foot claw, huh? That's nice.
Well done, man. Well done. So Pachycephalosaur, huh?
All right. Yeah.
That's a rare find.
Looking like a pachy vertebrae. Could be Thistlosaurus, but I'm thinking pachy. It's very spindly kind of shape. It's got the little type things there. Looks like a dorsal.
Huh. All right.
Just trying to figure out how to sitting up almost vertical here. All right, so Heather, we need to start mapping and logging this one.
Okay. Nice find.
Thank you.
So there's an Anotyrannus, and you can definitely see the serrations on it a little bit. I'm sorry, it's.
Still have the
blade. That's a Nanotyrannus. That is so awesome. Look at that. All right, well done.
Well done, my
young
catawan.
Funny, I saw it sitting there and I was like,
oh, mom.
Well, guys, we're about to wrap up the dig, and this is what I've did so far with the trike, and unfortunately, this is my last day here in the quarry, but it was a good one. We found a lot of scientifically important stuff. I've also found a claw that's about a centimeter in length, about the size of my pinky on the fingernail. And I'll show you what it looks like when we get to the field station in Bellefouche.
Well, that was fun. But luckily for us, this day is not over yet. A friend of Walter's named Robert De Palma from the Natural History Museum in Palm Beach, Florida, has arrived at the field station. Robert is known for discovering Dakota Raptor. This newly discovered raptor was a big, ferocious raptor, and I had the honor to meet him and interview him for it.
Hello, guys. This is the Paleo Ventures Outpost, and this here is Walter, and this is Robert. So, Dakota Raptor. This guy. So, who discovered this raptor?
This guy over here.
Alrighty, so what did you think when you first found this raptor?
Well, first thing I thought is, oh crap, we got something new. Huh. So, yeah. Obviously there's nothing else in the Hell Creek with a killing claw like that, so that was a really special thing. And there was no raptor this big previously known in the Hell Creek, so it was clear from day one there was something very new there. We didn't know how much there was, and we didn't know what it was closely related to, but we knew it was a new raptor, so it's just a big oh wow moment.
Right. Do you think it could be possibly related to Utah Raptor, which was a bit earlier?
Probably not. And the only reason, well, there are a few reasons, but Utah Raptor is quite a bit older. Mm-hmm. It splits off of a different lineage of the raptors as well. I mean, Utah Raptor is early Cretaceous.
Right.
And this guy was one of the last raptors known to exist on Earth. This was right up at the very, very latest Cretaceous. So there's probably no relation to Utah Raptor. In addition, the body proportions are very, very different. Utah Raptor is very stocky with very robust bones. Dakota Raptor has a very agile and lithe skeleton, so it has longer limb proportions. It was built for running rather than ambush predation.
That is so awesome.
Yeah.
So.
And this is the slashing claw, so this is literally how they bring down their prey. And there's a method called raptor prey restraint, which they would use this to hold down the prey item while they're eating it, just like modern birds of prey do.
Right. And the real scary thing is, this is just the bony part called the ungual. Now, in life, this is going to have a keratinaceous sheath over the top. It's going to almost double the length of this thing. This was a nasty talon, definitely designed for bringing down some...
And this thing would slash you.
This thing would slash you.
Yes.
Okay, and not to not to diminish the badassery of this thing, but it was a multi-use tool. It was like the Swiss Army weapon of the raptors. The bigger this bump is, the stronger the slashing stroke. And also, this is very unmistakably a raptor. You see how narrow this claw is. The blood grooves on either side are asymmetrical, meaning one is higher on one side than the other side. You can't see it very easily here, but there is a little subsidiary groove there, which is a characteristic of the very derived raptors. So this is raptor through and through. This you would not have wanted to tussle with out in Hell Creek.
No.
You know, with a claw that literally would have come out to about there, probably with the sheath. Yeah.
And a hell raptor.
A hell raptor, yes.
Chicken from hell.
Wow. Chicken from hell.
Speaking of that, is there any evidence of feathers on this guy? Or?
There is, actually. So Dakota Raptor is unique because it was very, very large. But it's also unique because of the feathers. So the way we know it had feathers, since we didn't find any feathers associated with it, is these really, really cool features on the arm. So this is the ulna. This is basically your lower arm bones. It would go like right there. But along the lower edge, right here, you can actually feel a row of bumps. They're called quill knobs.
Oh, yeah.
And a lot of modern birds have these because the feathers will directly attach via some ligaments right to the bone. If the bone has those quill knobs, you had substantial feathers on the wings. Couldn't fly with them. The raptor was way too big for that.
A little too heavy for that.
A little too heavy, too big. But it had long feathers for brooding, for hunting prey, for mantling the prey items and staying, you know, on top of them. But the cool thing is, no other predaceous dinosaur in the Hell Creek Formation had that feature. No raptor, no theropod of any kind, no dinosaur of any kind had that feature in the Hell Creek. Completely new. We know the other ones had feathers, but these had substantial feathers.
That is very amazing.
It's one of the cool features of this guy. And I think Walter here was actually one of the first people, I believe, to notice that on this bone, if I'm not mistaken, when I brought it in here one of the times.
Really?
Yeah, we had many, many discussions about these bones as it was being discovered. So we would always do a show and tell, and we would always, you know, note our little, you know, little observations on the bones. So, yeah.
Usually till about midnight.
Usually till about midnight.
Usually. There's a few beers involved, usually, on that. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, but we had some really good discussions. You know, for many, many years, we suspected there was a large raptor out there based on teeth and little bits and pieces of theropod bone that just didn't quite match the other theropods that were out there. And I seem to recall one evening you came by and you were sitting there talking about, well, you know, or do you think there's any bigger raptors out there? And we were both kind of discussing that. And I think at one point, this is now, of course, he's already found this thing now at that point. And he says, well, what should we call this? If there was a big raptor out there, Walter, what would you call it? And I'm sitting there thinking, well, probably Dakota Raptor. Dakota Raptor would be a good thing to call it. You got a Utah Raptor, you might as well have Dakota Raptor, right? And he's just smirking because he's already got the darn thing.
I really love the name, though.
I put out my secret hypothetical there and have him name it.
Yeah, right. It stays in your head. I just love the name. I mean, it's awesome. I mean,
it pays tribute to an awesome place. I mean, I've been doing research in South Dakota for so many years. It's a way to kind of give back to the state and say, hey, guess what? There's a really awesome new raptor on the scene. How about the state kind of gets to play a little role in that? It gets to forever be tied to South Dakota.
That is so amazing right there. And so, is there a scientific name to this animal?
Yeah, it's, well, the scientific name is binomial. So you've got a genus and a species. Mm-hmm. The genus is Dakota Raptor.
Right.
The species is Steini, after Walter Stein. So literally, Walter is named, you know, the raptor is named after Walter. He's part of the name. Because he played a role in it. He's been really instrumental in identifying stuff and supporting the whole research effort. And he's just been there behind the scenes the whole time.
Very kind. I did not deserve it. Very, very, very kind. Thank you.
That is so amazing. And Walter, how do you feel when you first found out this was named after you?
I thought, well, I could probably retire now and just go sit on the beach somewhere and drink margaritas. no, it's actually a huge honor. It's one of those things that most people never get that opportunity to have a species named after you, especially something as cool as Dakota Raptor. On one hand, it's awe, it's an amazing thing. You know, I remember growing up and seeing all these famous paleontologists who
who really actually deserve to have a dinosaur named after them. We've done a lot of things, a lot of research, and they've got their names on specimens. And for me to have joined that crowd, it's a big honor.
I can imagine. It's
a huge honor.
See, Tyler, this is, you know, this science is a lot about, well, in theory, and what should be in practice all the time, this science is a giving kind of a thing. So, you know, with you know, Walter's namesake there, that's giving back to a friend and a colleague, you know, a little bit what they gave to me. In the species itself, when I publish that, it is literally giving back to the world, and it's giving back to the scientific community. Because when this gets published, that essentially belongs to the world. It belongs to the scientific community, and it's my way of giving to them, giving to everybody something that they could then learn from and use in future research. So it's a totally giving experience. It's not a taking experience.
That is so amazing, guys, and thank you very much for this. This is really awesome.
Thumbs up.
Thumbs up. Well, we just got back from the field, and
yes,
so
we did.
I found this little claw right here. So what is it exactly?
Well, it's a good question. You know, a lot of times we don't know what these things are until we get them back to the lab, we put it back together again, we compare it to different things that have already been found in the past. This is a very, very interesting claw.
Here, I'll show you guys really quick.
It's hard to see it.
Yeah, it's that little guy.
Yeah, the tip is missing, but we've got two other little bits here we're gonna have to put back together again in the lab. It's got a really strong articular facet in there. There's no flexor tubercle on this particular thing, but the articular facet goes really way back towards the on the anterior side, on the dorsal side rather. Blood groove on both sides.
Yeah, that's what I first noticed about it when I plucked that out of the ground. I'm like, actually it was the wall, not the ground, but
yes.
And I'm like, what is this? And I, seeing that groove in there, I kind of knew it was a claw, and I called you over, and it's amazing. So,
yeah,
would this be a crocodile or a raptor? Maybe?
Possibly. It is hollow. If you look at it from the side, you can see that, especially in that one spot, there's a little bit of a hollow nature to the inside of that thing. And most of your small predatory dinosaurs are going to have hollow bones, very bird-like. Now, this one would certainly be a foot claw, not a hand claw, if that's the case. Really wish we had the tip on there to see how strongly curved it was. But I think there's a chance that that's from a small troodontid or a small raptor of some sorts. What I want to do eventually is once we get it put together, break open some of the research papers and really look at all the individual structures as close as we can.
That is amazing.
And then probably get to second or third, fourth opinions just to make sure.
Right. And then I believe a kid found this right here. It's a premax of a Tyrannosaurus.
Yeah, this was found by, this was found by a young boy named Matthias. And I think he was about 14 years old on one of our trips. Really cool juvenile premaxillary tooth from a Tyrannosaur. Not sure whether it's a Nanotyrannus or a T-Rex at this point. But it is serrated, so it's not your standard Ublisiodon, what has been traditionally called Ublisiodon at that point. It's got some very fine serrations. And you can always tell a premaxillary tooth because the serrations are kind of parallel to one another, and you've got that scooped kind of depression there on the interior side. So one of the fang tooths from the front of the premaxilla.
Right.
From the
snout. Yeah, that's pretty that's pretty interesting right there.
Yeah. What we'll do, one of the things that I'm working on right now is comparing all the teeth that we find from tooth draw, especially the young Tyrannosaurs, T-Rex and Nanotyrannus, comparing and contrasting them, measuring the serrations and the serrations per millimeter and all that, and trying to determine how many species of Tyrannosaurs we have out there, how many species of raptors we have out there, how many troodontids. And other things based on these little tiny teeth we get at tooth draw.
That's not all is what we found up there. So what else did we find? Something rare?
Well, this is very rare. This is one of my favorite types of dinosaurs. This is actually an Anzu claw. Anzu wilii was a giant oviraptor, giant North American oviraptor. And this is one that they typically called the chicken from hell. It's one of my favorites because I had a chance to work on this back in 1999 when I was working for Tribal Paleontology. A good friend of ours, the Nuss the Nuss family, Fred and Candy Nuss, basically found this really cool specimen. And they contacted us to go out and take a look at it. But anyway, Anzu is an awesome dinosaur. Toothless beak, very similar to a cassowary. Tall, crested head, big, sharp, nasty talons, strongly curved talons, and this wonderful flexor tubercle back here for muscle attachments. This thing just was a nasty animal. You wouldn't want to meet it in a dark alley. It wasn't necessarily a meat-eating dinosaur, although it probably did feed on small dinosaurs, small mammals, things like that. But it also had a diverse diet. Just like a cassowary, it might have been feeding on fruits and nuts and berries and mollusks. Inside the stomach contents of the one area, we actually found several gastropods, which is kind of interesting.
Snails,
yeah. So who knows what this thing was eating? It's a variety of different things. So the claws itself may have been used for a variety of different purposes, not just for prey acquisition by jumping on something and using those talons to hold it down and kill it, but also possibly for digging and rooting around in mud to pull up who knows what, their gastropods or whatever, and also for defense, as a defensive mechanism. You can imagine this giant 13, 14 foot long oviraptor, completely covered in feathers, most likely, with these massive claws in a display feature, if it was being attacked or something like that, to try and scare things away.
Right, and I've noticed on this claw, there are these little cavities right here,
yes.
As you can see right
weird.
Here.
Weird. We find a lot of our bones at Toothrow have these weird pits and grooves. And there's a variety of different hypotheses as to what's causing these. We're not entirely sure yet. There is a gentleman at University of Kansas. We donated a few bones from University of Kansas. He's looking at a duck-billed dinosaur bone, a big fibula, lower leg bone. He's looking at this and looking at all those pits and these little circular depressions, and he believes they're bug, from a beetle. Basically boring into the bones. So it's possible that this thing was sitting up on the floodplain for a while and being gnawed on and chewed on by different bugs and so on and so forth, beetles. It's also possible this is acid etching of some sort.
Acid, really?
Acid etching, yes. Yeah, depending on the acidity of the groundwater in the soils that it would have been in, it could have easily been eaten into some of this, into the claw here.
Huh.
Yeah.
That is so cool. I mean, today we had a really great day at Toothrow.
We had a pretty good day.
I loved it.
Yeah. We had a Pachycephalosaurus vertebrae. We had, of course, the baby, the young T-Rex tooth. We've got the claw. We had the Anzu claw. We actually had a Thesaurosaurus claw as well.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Yeah, that one's another one. Now, that one looked like it tumbled for a little bit. It's weathered. It's the edges are abraded. So that one may have traveled quite a bit before it finally got buried in that deposit.
And there's that Triceratops frill I was working on.
Of course. How did we forget that? That was a huge, huge chunk of Triceratops, wasn't it?
Yeah. Right, so what was it called again? Was it a...
I don't like to make determinations as to what it is until it's out of the ground and we've had a chance to prepare it and look at it. Based on what I'm seeing on the one side, it's probably a big piece of the frill. Most likely the squamosal.
Somewhere like back here a little?
Yeah, the Triceratops or, you know, good old three-horned face. This one has a frill of bone that protects the back of its neck. It's also good for display. It makes the animal look bigger and tougher and stronger and meaner. That frill is actually composed of the back of the skull. And there's four bones. They're paired bones. The squamosal, the parietal squamosal. Okay?
Huh.
Now, as far as which one of those it is, I'm not 100% certain. Based on what I can see so far, it looks like the base of the squamosal.
Oh, well, we'll stay tuned then.
Yeah, and I wish you could have stuck around for another few days and actually got that out of the ground. Unfortunately,
oh, yeah.
Not gonna have a chance to do that yet.
That was awesome. Mm-hmm. I mean, but unfortunately, all good things have to come to an end. And Paleo Adventures,
yeah.
I highly recommend come visit them in South Dakota. There, you'll have a ball. You'll have a ball. I love these guys. They're so great. And thanks again, Walter,
Thank
for
you.
Bringing me along.
Thank
this
you.
Trip.
No problem. Anytime,
and we'll see
buddy.
You guys next video.
Later.
Well, we're here at the Dino Lab. Oops, wrong place. I was thinking of going somewhere.
Hi-ho, hi-ho, it's off to dig we go.
Found it. It's right here.
Like that.
Yes, ladies and gentlemen, I slid. That's why you gotta be careful filming while you're walking on the Badlands.
But yeah, the bone's still there.
All right, guys, so we're here at the Dino, Dino Lab?
There's some outtakes, yeah.
I guess so, okay. Yeah. Well, hello, guys. We're back at the field station at Paleo Adventures, and this here is Bill Lestern. Nine?
Howard Stern.
Bill Sterneye? Who's that?
Sterno.
Is there somebody behind me now?
Sterno caudal dislocation.
Yeah. I'm sorry, it's Bill Stern, right?
Stein.
Stein.
Walter Stein.
My goodness, we get you one beer and you're already loopy.
That's right. Yeah. That's what happens to those Californianers.
Yeah. Oh, that's
should have wine. Should have had some wine.
I don't drink wine.
All right. Hello, guys.
My fellow Americans. I am running for president. Keep cracking them up. We'll never get through this.
Oh my god.
Okay. Well, hello, guys, and this is the field station in Paleo Adventures, and this is Walter Stern.
That's commercial!
Okay.
Oh god.
Oh my goodness.
There will be.
There's no. Shoot, what's the name? Brain melt. Time out. Redo. Stop. Hey. Blah, blah, blah. What do you call it? Flexor tubercle. There you are. Thank you.